సార్ గుడ్ ఈవినింగ్ సార్
గుడ్ ఈవినింగ్ రాజేష్ చెప్ప
ఓకే సార్ షల్ వి స్టార్ట్ ది మీటింగ్ సార్
యా షూర్ హూస్ ప్రెజెంటింగ్ ఇట్ అండ్
సార్ మై సెల్ఫ్ ఓన్లీ సార్
ఓకే గో అహెడ్
yes sir
మన లక్ష్మణ్ అండ్ అదర్ పీపుల్ హావ్ జాయిన్
yes sir
yes sir జాయిన్ సార్
జాయిన్
yes sir
లోకే
yes sir local also there sir
okay fine go ahead
okay sir sir my patient is 43 year male
yes sir
sir 43 year male by name Jagan working as agricultural laborer came from Adilabad studied up to 4th class sir with chief complaints of chest pain on and off since 14 years
14 years
yes sir
so is almost on the age of 29 years
29 years sir
yeah 29 years a 2 year chest pain okay
yes sir
1 minute Rajesh prasanth mal call chestunna I'm in a meeting
yes sir came with chief complaints of chest pain on and off since 14 years that is from the age of 29 years and episodic palpitations since 4 years sir
palpitations yeah 4 years okay
yes coming to issue of present illness 14 years back at the age of 29 years he noticed the chest heaviness retrosternal without any radiation relieved by without any radiation associated with exertion relieved by taking rest for about 10 to 15 minutes sir and there is no issue of shortness while doing regular agricultural activities there is no issue of postprandial angina no issue of rest angina and there is no issue of trauma and no issue of shortness of breath and no issue of PND or apnea sir and there is no issue of pedal edema abdominal distension cough or wheeze and there is no issue of palpitations or syncope during that period sir so these complaints lasted for 3 months sir at that time after 3 months he went to hospital evaluated and underwent a procedure through the right groin sir and advised medications
where in Hyderabad or somewhere else
in Hyderabad only sir in Hyderabad only sir. So and advised medication sir after that he was discharged but he continued to have chest pain on his daily activities Canadian Cardiovascular Society initially functional class 2 sir then progressed to functional class 3 despite
this
the
is treatment. After the procedure this is after the procedure or
sir after the procedure sir
so the procedure was according to the patient was unsuccessful integra
yes sir
he had angina sir. Before and he continues to have angina even after the procedure okay go ahead
yes and
was it a therapeutic procedure or was it a diagnostic procedure
sir it is a diagnostic procedure sir as per history they told that diagnostic procedure sir
diagnostic procedure okay
yes sir diagnostic procedure and these complaints progressed to functional class 3 over 1 year sir because of that he curtailed his activity to avoid the chest pain and restricted to house and after that he used to take medications from the local practitioners for symptomatic relief but he has not relieved of his symptoms sir
so what do you think is the what about the palpitation you say
sir here still more some history is left
yeah.
sir
yeah.
so 6 years back again with these complaints he came to another corporate hospital in Hyderabad so he was evaluated and told that he he needed a surgery for his cardiac problem and a diagnostic procedure done before the surgery. He underwent the procedure. No, sir. So he only underwent the surgery was advised, sir.
But not, he did not undergo.
Yes, sir. Mm-hmm. But he underwent only diagnostic procedure, but he did not undergo surgery in view of financial constraints.
Mm-hmm.
So then there is history of palpitation since 4 years, sudden onset, irregular, feeling of rapid heart rate, sudden upset, not related to exertion, and no post palpitation diuresis, and no history of giddiness or loss of consciousness during the episode, sir.
Mm-hmm.
So with this came with this
complaints, he came. What was the duration
of palpitations? So duration of palpitations 4 years, sir.
No. Once you get a palpitation,
yes, sir.
How long the palpitation lasts?
Sir, as per his history, he is telling that sometimes it may be like up to 10 to 15 minutes, sir. Sometimes it may be up to 5 minutes, sir.
Okay. And sudden onset and upset.
Sudden onset and upset, sir. Not related to exertion.
Exertion. Okay.
Sir, with these complaints, he came to hospital for further evaluation and underwent a diagnostic procedure through the right radial artery before the surgery and awaiting for the surgery, sir.
Okay. So, what do you think is happening here? Patient who developed
angina
at the age of 29 years.
Yes, sir. My first possibility with this longish duration of angina, first possibility is I am thinking dynamic alveolar aorta obstruction, sir. Hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, I am thinking, sir.
Why are you thinking only HOCM? Why can't it be plain, simple aortic valve?
Sir, aortic wall stenosis survival up to after development of angina is 5 years only, sir, without any intervention.
Mm-hmm. So yes, they survived beyond that. So you think it is
aortic stenosis is less likely, sir.
Aortic wall stenosis is less likely.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. And second possibility, I am thinking mitral wall prolapse with mitral regurgitation, sir.
Mitral wall prolapse with mitral regurgitation. But do they develop angina, classical angina, what you have described?
No, sir.
Most of the patients with MVPs have got some non-ischemic chest pains.
Yes, sir.
So, and they underwent a right radial procedure will be in coronary angiogram, most likely.
Yes, sir. Coronary angiogram, sir.
So what kind of surgery they are planning for after the coronary angiogram, if it is only HOCM?
I am thinking maybe myectomy, sir. Myectomy.
Maybe myectomy is a bit very rare to do it, but basically, how do you explain the arrhythmias in that? Is it possible that the patient has got a chronic rheumatic heart disease?
Sir, chronic rheumatic heart disease, I would like to consider mitral stenosis, sir, but I cannot explain the symptoms of breathlessness. Patient did not have breathlessness, sir, during the course of illness. He's only having chest pain.
Mm-hmm. You don't think that tight MS can cause chest pain?
Yes, sir. Tight MS, secondary to right ventricular development of pulmonary arterial hypertension, right ventricular hypertrophy can cause angina. But there are no symptoms of breathlessness and no symptoms and signs of right-sided heart failure, sir.
So, because of absence of right-sided heart failure, you are thinking it is unlikely to be a
yes, sir.
Heart,
yes, sir.
Then, from the history, it looks such a prolonged history of almost 14, 15 years going along.
Yes, sir.
Is a bit, difficult to, as you correctly said, isolated aortic wall stenosis, difficult, because for 14 years is unlikely. But basically, occurrence of this angina plus the palpitation paroxysmal likely that the patient has got a multivalvular heart disease, wherein the patient has got MS and AS, or MR and AS, and that is causing the problems of chest pain and restlessness. That's my way of looking at it. It's also possible the patient has got HOCM, right? But HOCM, you know, only having angina, not having syncope on effort or doing anything, is again a bit unusual.
Yes,
MBPS with MR, you know, going on MBPS with MR, classical angina is less likely. Any other diagnosis you would like to entertain apart from these things?
Coronary artery disease, coronary artery disease, one possibility, sir.
What type of coronary artery disease? Atherosclerotic, yes, or non-atherosclerotic?
Non-atherosclerotic.
Like? Non-atherosclerotic, like what? Like what type of non-atherosclerotic coronary artery disease?
Coronary artery anomalies, sir. Coronary artery
anomalies. Like?
RCA abnormal alkappa one possibility, sir, but it is rare up to this survival. They can have, but they can present in the childhood, they can present with heart failure.
And they can also present with angina anyway, but why can't you think of anomalous origin and anomalous course causing angina?
Yes, sir.
Of 29 years. So one of them is atherosclerotic coronary artery disease. For the patient to develop obstructive coronary artery disease at the age of 29, he must be having a what you call familial hypercholesterolemia, you know, to cause an obstructive coronary artery disease at this age. And if that is the case, then going on for 14 years is a bit unusual without any medication. Even with medication also, they do develop a lot of progression of the disease is much faster with familial hypercholesterolemia. So, non-atherosclerotic coronary artery disease, one of them is probably the patient has got aortoarteritis is one of the things. Less likely in a male, but not cannot be ruled out completely with ostial, what you call stenosis of the right coronary artery or LMCA disease. LMCA disease less likely because it has gone on for 14 years. Then other non-atherosclerotic coronary artery disease like anomalous origin and interarterial course of the anomalous course of the coronary artery. So that is one of the possibilities. Anomalous, you know, young fellow having angina and no family, no lipid abnormalities, no other risk factors. Probably that's one of the things you need to think is anomalous, what we call origin, and course has to be interarterial course usually. It is between the pulmonary artery and the aorta, and that gets compressed, and that becomes worse during the exercise. So that's one of the things is, so non-atherosclerotic coronary artery disease is this one. Third non-atherosclerotic coronary artery disease is spontaneous coronary artery dissection. At the age of 29, unless he has a connective tissue disorder, it is less likely. It can still happen unless there is hypertension. More likely in a female, especially during pregnancy, or the patient has been, you know, having some other connective tissue disorder, which makes him more likely to have a dissection. So that is one of the things you can have it. And non-atherosclerotic coronary artery disease, coronary artery spasm is one of the things that can happen. Then microvascular angina, more likely in a female, but can also happen. So you need to have some non-atherosclerotic coronary artery diseases to be considered.
Okay.
So okay, I feel that probably, I still feel that probably it's a valvular heart disease, but anomalous origin, non-atherosclerotic, less likely in the absence of risk factors, more likely a non-atherosclerotic vascular disease, including one of them being the anomalous origin and interarterial folks, and of course aortoarteritis, then spontaneous arterial dissections, then coronary artery spasm. Any other ideas? Okay, let's go to the physical examination.
Yes.
Anything in the past history relevant?
Sir, in the past history, there are no risk factors, sir. Mm-hmm. And there is no history of usage of medications which require frequent blood monitoring. Mm-hmm. And personal history takes mixed diet, bowel and bladder are normal, sleep good, sir. No, not a smoker, not an alcohol. Family history, he is second child, sir, in the family. Mm-hmm. And other siblings were normal. 6 years back, in view of this cardiac issue, he was advised to do family screening, sir. And echo was done.
Family screening, is it?
Yes, so sir. Yes, sir.
There is an inherited disorder.
Yes, sir.
Most likely to be an obstruction. HOCM is a possibility. Okay, go ahead.
Yes, sir. Advised to do family screening. Echo was done to the family members, but it was normal, sir. Mm-hmm. And coming to the general physical examination, sir, height is 177 centimeters, weight is 80 kgs, and BMI 25.5 kg per meter square, sir.
Mm-hmm.
Upper segment to lower segment ratio 1:1, sir. There is no pallor, icterus, cyanosis, clubbing, or lymphadenopathy or pedal edema.
Mm-hmm.
There are no signs of musculoskeletal abnormalities and musculoskeletal abnormalities, sir. Spine examination normal, sir. Pulse rate, coming to the vitals, temperature febrile, pulse rate is 74 per minute, regular, normal volume, brisk pulse is there, sir.
No, you have to describe a bit more, especially if you're suspecting an obstructive cardiomyopathy. Hypertrophic, yes. Obstructive cardiomyopathy.
Yes,
double peak pulse, single peak pulse, brisk, brisk or?
Yes, sir. Brisk double pulse is there, sir. The double pulse in the systole, sir.
That's a bit rare. Although it has been, it is documented on the, graphic recordings, physical examination, double systolic impulse of the radial pulse is a bit unusual. So the brisk upstroke is there. So what is the rule out, brisk upstroke?
So it will rule out fixed LVOT obstruction, sir.
Yeah, okay. At least severe fixed obstruction. Yeah.
Yes, sir. All peripheral pulses felt, no radio femoral delay. Yes, sir. Blood pressure
vessel
is
vessel wall.
There is no thickening of vessel wall, sir.
Vessel wall not palpable. Okay.
Not palpable, sir. Yes, sir. Blood pressure in the supine position in right upper limb 130/80, left upper limb 130/80, both lower limbs 140 systolic mmHg, sir. Sir, respiratory rate 12 per minute, jugular venous pressure not elevated, normal waveform, normal inspiratory fall, and abdominal jugular reflex negative, sir. Coming to precardial examination, inspection and palpation combined. Chest is bilaterally symmetrical. Apex beat is in the left fifth intercostal space, 1/2 inch medial to the midclavicular line. Heaving in nature, double apical impulse present, sir.
No, you'll have to say, what do you mean by double apical impulse? Is it a palpable S4?
Sir, there's a palpable S4 present at the apex, sir.
You say that specifically, yes. So it is a pre-systolic pulsation and systolic outward movement.
And there is no palpable thrill and no other palpable sounds and no parasternal or epigastric pulsation, sir.
So the palpable S4, what is the implication?
Sir, first thing is it will rule out atrial fibrillation, sir. Second thing is there is no obstruction between the atrium and ventricle, sir. Corresponding atrium and ventricle.
So, you mean to say normally also it can...
non-compliant LV, sir.
Yeah, so it indicates a lot of resistance to the ventricular filling. Okay?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So, it is a decreased compliance of the ventricle with good communication between atrium and left atrium and left ventricle. And in sinus rhythm. Okay.
Percussion, left heart border corresponding to apex, right heart border retrosternal, sir. Left second intercostal space is resident, sir.
Mm-hmm.
auscultation, first heart sound normal intensity, second heart sound, two components are heard, normally split and normal intensity, sir, both components. S4 heard at the apex, there are no other additional sounds, sir. In the left third and fourth intercostal space, I could hear a harsh medium pitched crescendo decrescendo, mid systolic murmur with mid peaking occupying two third of systole, which is not radiating to carotids, which is increased on standing and decreased with squatting position and hand grips.
It is not conducted to the carotid. Don't say radiating. It is not conducted to the carotids.
Okay, sir.
Any other murmur?
Sir, there is at the apex, I could hear another murmur, sir. A high-pitched pan-systolic murmur of grade 3/6. Best head with the diaphragm expression in left lateral position, not radiating to axilla, which is increased on hand grip, sir.
Not conducted to the axilla.
Sir, not conducted to axilla, sir.
Axilla.
Which is increased on hand grip, sir.
Increased on hand grip.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, what is the, what about the mid-systolic murmur, the dynamic auscultation?
Sir, mid-systolic murmur increased on standing, sir, and decreased with the squatting and hand grip, sir.
Why do you want to do hand grip when you are making him squat?
Yes, sir.
So basically, better that, you know, you just say standing and squatting. Okay.
Yes. Sir, other system there are no other murmurs, sir. Other system examination normal, sir. My provisional diagnosis is severe left ventricular outflow tract obstruction at the subbulbar level, dynamic LVOT obstruction, probably hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. Yes, sir. Yeah.
Definitely, you know, the dynamic. You said you're done already dynamic auscultation, and then said by decreasing the preload, the murmur is increasing, and by increasing the afterload, the murmur is decreasing. So, why do you want to add the word probably, which when after having made all the right things?
Yes, okay. Sir. Okay. With the mild mitral regurgitation, presently in sinus rhythm. Maybe not in CCF, in NYHF functional class 3, no, without PAH, no evidence of infected endocarditis.
Yeah. Presently he is in class 3 or class 2?
Presently he is in class 3, sir.
Okay. What is the second diagnosis? First one is HOCM, you said. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Second diagnosis? You need to have second alternate diagnosis. Otherwise, you know, they might think that you know the diagnosis, you know the answer.
Yes. The subvolar aortic stenosis is possibility is there, sir.
Subvolar
aortic stenosis is.
No, no. How many types of subvolar fixed obstructions are there?
Sir, associated with aortic stenosis and associated with...
No.
So, yes,
how many types of subvolar obstruction in LVOT? Associated with... Also, you get discrete obstruction, you get tubular obstruction.
Yes.
Discrete obstruction is membrane, subaortic membrane. And tunnel-like obstruction is a diffuse one. So, these are all a bit unusual in a... But... is it still possibility? What is against the diagnosis?
Sir, there is dynamic auscultation, sir.
No, what is one feature here which makes it, what do you call, less likely to be a fixed obstruction?
Sir, murmur increasing and standing and decreasing with squatting, sir.
Increasing and standing. Does it happen with the fixed obstruction? What is the response of the murmur in fixed obstruction?
Sir, with the standing increases, sir.
No, fixed obstruction.
Sir, fixed obstruction decreases, sir.
Decreases because?
Venous return decreases, sir.
So the payload is decreased, so the movement decreases. Whereas here, I'm standing, the murmur is increasing because?
The cavity size will decrease, sir.
So
cavity size decreases, so the gradient decreases, sir.
No, don't say gradient, is a manifestation. So because the cavity size decreases, the obstruction increases.
Obstruction increases, sir.
Yeah, because obstruction increases, the murmur becomes longer.
Yes.
So you should say that. Why does the murmur become less unsquatting?
Sir, there will be increased systemic vascular resistance, sir, after load. So the murmur will decrease, sir.
So there will be less obstruction.
Yes, sir.
Because as I said, O equals to C minus D. So if the distensibility is increased, the obstruction will become less. By increasing the pressure in the aorta, the distensibility of the ventricle is increased.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So once the distensibility of the LV is increased, the obstruction will become less.
Yes.
So since the obstruction becomes less, the murmur also becomes less.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Let's see the. What do you want to have a look?
Sir, I want to see ECG, sir.
Okay. So your diagnosis is HOCM first one. Second one is subaortic subvolar fixed obstruction.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Any other thing?
Could be mild aortic stenosis with mitral regurgitation. Aortic stenosis with mitral regurgitation.
Mild AS with aortic regurgitation.
Mitral regurgitation.
Go ahead. ECG. Let's see the ECG.
I'm projecting. One minute, sir. Sir, okay.
Yeah, go ahead. Not able to see it anyway.
Can you see, sir?
Sorry? No, I'm not able to see.
Sir, 1 minute, sir, at the same time.
Is a problem in projecting the...
Yes, sir. There's some problem, sir.
Okay. Read the ECG, whatever it is.
Sir, give me 1 minute, sir. I'm projecting, sir.
Okay.
हेलो 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 सर
राजेश सपोज
सर
नॉट एबल टू सी इट
सर लोकल नो प्रोजेक्ट चला ओके ओके सर सॉरी सर
पहले ये बच्चा दो ये बच्चे रीड दी
सर देयर इज सम टेक्निकल प्रॉब्लम्स सर प्रीवियसली इट वाज नॉट देयर
ओके सर You interpret the ECG, read it
yes,
out.
Sir. Okay, sir. Sir, this is 12 lead 4 channel ECG, sir.
Mm-hmm.
I'll forward to your WhatsApp, sir, so that you can see, sir.
That's okay, no problem.
Sir, this is a 12, yes, sir. It's a 12 lead, 4 channel 12 lead ECG with lead 2 as rhythm shaper showing axis of around minus 45, sir. And there is a left atrial enlargement is there, sir, by Morris index. And there is poor option, and there is ST depression with the T inversions are there, sir, from V4 to V6. So suggestive of left ventricular hypertrophy and left atrial enlargement.
Left ventricular hypertrophy.
You want to qualify it? So it's a LV strain pattern, sir, actually. This is LV strain pattern.
Pressure overload.
Pressure overload.
Yes, LV pressure overload.
Yes.
Yes. So, the case of LVH, it is, and is not hypertensive, so basically, does go in favor of a HOCM or HCM. What about the X-ray?
X-ray. Yes, sir. Lokra, can you project X-ray? To your WhatsApp, sir.
Yeah, okay.
So this is.
I'll have a look.
Sir, yeah. This is chest X-ray.
Yeah. I'm able to do it now.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Sir,
is it seen, sir?
Yeah, yeah. I'm able to see it. Okay. What do you want to comment on this?
Sir, this is chest X-ray PA view, sir. This slightly overexposed and rotated to left. There is cardiomegaly present, sir. Mild cardiomegaly is there. With there is no right atrial enlargement, and there is no pulmonary artery enlargement, sir. There is increased pulmonary vascularity in the upper lobes, sir, slightly.
You can't say increased vascularity. What do you call that?
Increased pulmonary venous.
Upper lobe venous distension. Upper lobe
vascular. Yes, sir. Upper lobe venous distension is there, sir.
Consistent with pulmonary venous hypertension.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
So, how much will be the left atrial pressure with this X-ray?
Yes, sir. 80-20, sir. More than 14. More than. Lokra, can you project 2 days ago?
2 days.
Yes, Lokra.
Lokra. Yeah. Oh, one minute. I'm just looking for.
Yeah, it is seen now. Seen on the screen. Yeah.
So this is parasternal long axis, sir, showing thickened interventricular septum with dilated left atrium. This is MOD across the aorta and left atrium, sir. So. Lokra, background noise is there. Can you mute yourself? Yes, sir. Lokra, it was stuck.
Yeah, okay.
Sir, this is a mode showing a systolic counter motion, sir. A mode across the mitral wall leaflet.
What about the pattern of motion of the
systolic anterior motion of IVS is there, sir.
IVS?
Anterior mitral leaflet, sir. Sorry.
No, but what do you see about the motion of the IVS? Is it normal, decreased, or increased?
So it will be decreased, sir, actually.
Because of here, what is happening? Yeah.
Here also, there is decreased movement of the interventricular septum, sir. Yeah. Thickened, but posterior wall is moving relatively well, sir, compared to the septum.
What about the RV free wall?
And also, appear to be thickened, sir, slightly.
Thickened, yeah. So looks like either Arya Freewall is also involved. So let us really measure it. Unless it is more than 4 mm.
Yes.
Okay. Anything else you want to comment on the echocardiogram about the anything about morphology of the?
Yes, sir. Myocardium is thickened, sir. Interventricular septum, and there is mitral leaflet. Architecture is normal, sir. Sorry, papillary muscle attachment appears to be normal only, sir.
How do you say that? Which view you should take it to say it is papillary muscle?
Yeah, actually, four chamber, sir. Four chamber.
Four chamber, do you see papillary muscles?
Oh, sorry. This basal short axis view, sir. Sorry. Basal short axis view,
you will see.
Yeah, the, papillary muscle attachments.
Papillary muscle attachments. And if at all you want to see anything else long axis wise, it will be apical three chamber view. Apical three chamber view. You will see whether there is any abnormal position of the mitral apparatus.
Okay, sir.
So, is there any MR here or no MR?
Sir. There is a mild MR is there, sir.
You want to say anything else about?
Sir, mild MR is there MR and is
going to be, you know.
This is four chamber view, sir. Actually showing there is a mid cavitary gradient is there, sir.
Portion of the, this is four chamber view.
Yes, sir. Four chamber view, sir. There's a gradient across
the turbulence
at LVOT. The,
and also below that also. Yeah.
Yes, sir. LVOT and mid cavitary gradient.
The Doppler profile.
Sir. Didn't get this mosaic pattern.
Yeah. You just go back. Actually, it was
mosaic pattern.
Mosaic pattern is the obstruction occurring at the beginning or in the middle or in the late.
Sir, is
that?
Please,
yes, sir.
Dagger shaped.
Dagger shape means what?
Yes, sir.
Dagger shape means, why the dagger shape?
Obstruction occurring in the mid to late systole, not in early systole.
There is no obstruction in the early systole. That's why you don't get anything in the early portion. Only in the later portion, mid portion or beyond mid portion, then only you get obstruction. That's why the peak velocity. What is the peak velocity there? I think it's going beyond 4.
So, 4, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah, beyond 4, yeah. So, but at the onset of the systole, there is no significant obstruction. The velocity is only about 1.5 meters per second. So this is a classical of what?
So this is classical of hypertrophic myopathy, sir. Dagger shaped. Mid systolic obstruction.
Yeah, dagger shaped obstruction usually indicates sub-aortic and dynamic. You see, dynamic because in the early portion, it is not fixed because the obstruction is starting in the mid systole. Okay. If it is fixed, it should start right from the beginning.
Yes.
Anything else you want to comment about the paper, about the echocardiogram?
The cavity is obliterated, sir. LV cavity is obliterated and there is dilated LA.
What else do you expect or prognostically? Is the apex looks normal or abnormal?
Apex is hypokinesia is there, sir.
Apart from hypokinesia, look at the distal septum, you see that? It looks like a handout, actually.
Yes, sir.
There is no aneurysm, there is no... See that compared to the proximal and mid, look at the distal portion.
It's thinned out.
See that?
Yeah. Yes, sir.
And it looks like a bulging to me. It's like a small ventricular aneurysm. Why is it important? You know?
Sir, LV aneurysm, LV apical aneurysm is a subset of high risk.
Sudden
cardiac death. Especially, it is the area for origin of the arrhythmias.
Yes, sir.
It's a high risk subset. Okay, this is tissue Doppler in the lateral
mitral.
Yeah, lateral mitral aneurysm. You see that now also? You see the septum in the distal area compared to the.
Yes, sir. So that is the.
It does look like there is. There is dynamic obstruction. There is SAM.
Yes,
to look at the apex, I'm very suspicious of it. You know. So how do you confirm it?
Sir, we'll do cardiac MRI, sir. Cardiac MRI, we'll see for the thickening of septal thickness we can assess and apical aneurysm and late gadolinium enhancement, more than 15% is also high risk for sudden cardiac death.
You see that, you know, that area, apical area looks to me like it's very thin. It is not normal. It is less than normal, right? And it looks like bulging there. You see that? So that may be the reason why patient is having it with the arrhythmia.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, you think he falls into a low risk category or a high risk category?
Yeah, it's a high risk category, sir.
Because?
Sir, high risk category because first thing is LV thickness is more, sir.
No, LV thickness more? Is. You didn't measure it.
Actually, it should be at least more than 30 mm, sir. LV thickness more than 30 mm is a high risk, sir. And there is a LV.
Wait. The people should start with history. Any family yes, sir. Sudden cardiac death?
There is no family history of sudden cardiac death, sir.
Then any history of syncope?
There is no history of syncope and there is no history of cardiac arrest also, sir.
So basically, so these are all, you know, I think when you are asked the examination, it goes systematically so that you will have an idea. Then you go with morphological abnormalities.
Okay.
Morphological abnormalities are, these are all the things. LVH beyond 30 millimeters. Anything else?
And
patient with LVOT obstruction versus non-LVOT obstruction.
Sir, LVOT obstruction, patient more prone to heart failure, but because heart of... newer guidelines, it is a high risk, sir. LVOT
gradient. Yeah. So it does fall into the high risk category.
Yes.
So occurrence of the this ventricular aneurysms and everything are also high risk.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Then what else other things are there? Then did you do a TMT?
Then there is a TMT, abnormal BP response, sir. Either rise in absence of rise in BP or fall in BP is abnormal, sir. And in TMT, in Holter, non-sustained VT for Holter for more than 48 hours, non-sustained VT at least one or more run of non-NSVT is abnormal, sir. And we had to do the echo. Echo LVH more than 30 mm. And in MRI, late gadolinium enhancement with more than 15% is a high-risk patient, sir.
So there are all these. So if you go systematically, then you're not going to miss out. Okay.
Yes, sir.
So that's what it is. So
yes,
because you said it is a high risk. So
yes, sir.
How many factors are there in this patient? Except probably arrhythmia and what do you call hypertrophy, nothing else is there.
Yes, sir.
So there is a scoring system, no? For this.
Yes, sir. European Society of Cardiology, they have given a scoring system, sir. Actually, based
so
on these
factors,
based on these factors only,
yeah.
No, sir, I did not do. Based on these factors only, they have included age also, sir. Age and LA diameter they have added, sir. Age and LA diameter, based on that, they gave me a scoring, sir. Scoring.
So you need to know these things because in exam, because you have said, you have blotted out, exam that didn't ask you. You said he falls into a high risk category. This is where the problem arises. You have invited the question, the answer of which you are not fully aware of it. So in the examination, it is better to limit your answer to the question asked. Unless he asked, how do you risk stratify them and all those things are the different issue. Okay, so you... We have to calculate the score. At least you can say calculate the score using the European Society Cardiology guidelines.
Yes, sir.
So what do you have to offer to this patient now?
Yeah. So I'll do cardiac MRI, sir, first. So I'll
cardiac
see
MRI,
for the
enhancement is only 5%. Let us say VP response is normal on exercise.
Yes, sir. So we can offer medical management, sir, but as per his history, he is taking medications which are not useful. So we can...
what are the drugs you are going to prescribe?
Sir, first choice is beta blocker, sir. Second choice is verapamil we can give, sir. But verapamil with obstruction, it will not work, sir. We can give diazoparamide also, sir.
No. What is your prescription, medical prescription for this patient?
So we'll give beta blocker, sir.
Which beta blocker?
Cardioselective beta blocker,
no,
sir.
You have to say the name, you know.
Yes,
don't,
sir.
Don't keep on... Which
sorry,
beta
sir.
Blocker he is asking?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Propranolol is more helpful, sir. Propranolol.
Yeah, you have to say that. You know, propranolol, how much dosage?
40 mg... twice daily.
3 times daily and then adjust the dosage depending upon the heart rate and blood pressure. Okay.
Yes. Yes.
Poor response to propranolol, then what next?
So we can add diazoparamide.
What is the new drug available now for treatment of HOCM?
Mavacamten, sir. Mavacamten is
sir. So what? How does it work?
Sir, it's a myosin activator, sir.
So how does it work? It is a myosin ATPase, if I'm not mistaken.
Yes, sir.
So, how does it work and in what way that is better than diazepamide? Does it improve the symptoms? Does it increase the quality of life? Or does it improve the longevity of life? These are all the things you have to know. Otherwise,
yes,
you know, it is better means, you know, then the examiner is going to ask you how. Is it available in our country? As on today?
No, sir.
It's not available, yeah. So basically, you have to know these things. Now, having given all the drugs, the patient is unresponsive. So what next?
Sir, we can offer either surgical myectomy or we can offer alcohol septal ablation, sir. So depending on the...
In the examination, don't say that. The first treatment of choice for... treatment of symptomatic, medically refractory HOCM is? First option is?
Surgeries.
Surgery.
Yes, sir.
So, first option is surgery. Yes. Only when there are, when the risk of surgery is high, then only you go for septal ablation, all septal ablation.
Yes, sir.
So basically that is the way it is. So what is the mortality with us in good centers? Surgical risk for
around 5%, sir. 5%.
Yeah. There is a special issue has come on hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. Okay? You better read it.
Okay, sir.
So that's the way it is. So anything else? He said I think family screening has been done already.
Yes, sir.
So would you like to do any genetic testing?
Sir, genetic testing can be done, sir. But
no, no. Would you ask him to get a genetic testing? What is the current thing here? What is the purpose?
So to identify the high risk subset, sir, like if it is troponin positive, so
what are the high risk for sudden cardiac.
Genetic testing is not required, sir. They have to do by echocardiography only, sir.
Okay. So basically you have to do that. Okay. So the patient now is in class 3 according to you. So basically the younger the age of onset of the disease, the worse is the prognosis. So he started to develop symptoms at the age of 28-29. So it's not a good thing. As compared to a person who develops the symptoms of HOCM at the age of 50-60, it probably is better. As compared to those people where the onset of the disease is in the childhood or in the early adulthood, their prognosis is much worse. Okay?
Okay, sir.
Anything else you would like to? No, but in the examination, this will be theory. Understand that, especially in these days of COVID, you will have to know more about it.
Yes, sir.
Is there a role of myocardial perfusion imaging in patients with HOCM? Mm. Especially in a patient with angina.
Yes, sir. Perfusion defects maybe associated coronary artery disease could be there, sir.
Already coronary angiogram done, man.
Yes, sir. Normal, sir. Normal.
Yeah. Yeah, they do get myocardial perfusion defects, actually. Supposed to be microvascular disease.
To identify the microvascular disease.
Yeah, but because that also is a, what you call, a high risk factor.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
So, you know, this, there's a special issue on HOCM cardiology clinics. I'll tell you the issue. Issue is cardiology clinics, February 2019. The entire issue is on hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, including the genetics and including the stratification and the surgery, role of pharmacotherapy, and choice of septal reduction therapies, all these things. It is edited by an Indian, Srihari Naidu.
Okay, sir. Yes.
Role of advanced testing, including this cardiopulmonary testing, endomyocardial biopsies, all these things. Sudden cardiac death risk evaluation. So this is the one where it says clinical features associated with increased risk of sudden cardiac death in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. Traditional risk factors, other risk factors or risk modifiers. What he calls as risk modifiers. Traditional risk factors are prior history of arrhythmia or sudden cardiac death, Family history of sudden cardiac death and HCM, unexplained syncope, non-SVT, non-sustained VT, maximal LV wall thickness over 30 millimeters, abnormal BP response. Okay, these are the traditional risk factors. Then risk modifiers are LVOT gradient more than 30 millimeters, myocardial fibrosis on CMR imaging, LA diameter and size, and specific genetic mutations, younger age, and LV apical endolysis. These are all modifiers. They are not the traditional risk factor. That means modifiers means if they are there, it will increase the risk. But by themselves, they are not inducers.
Okay.
So basically, you should read this issue, the whole issue. So basically now, what is the role of ICD implantation in this patient?
Sir, so if it is high risk patient, ICD should be kept, sir. Mm-hmm. And with the life expectancy more than 1 year, we have to put the ICDs. Like as a primary prevention, as a secondary prevention, sir. As a secondary prevention in patients with having cardiac arrest or issue of syncope.
He has arrhythmias. We really don't know what kind of arrhythmias is that. If it is VT, then I think we need to do it. So,
yes.
I think you should read it and then also read about the role of myocardial perfusion imaging in patients with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy.
Okay.
And for evaluation of the papillary muscles of abnormality, one of them is what we call the short axis view. Other one is the three-chamber view.
Yes, sir.
These two are the three are important. And even papillary muscle hypertrophy is also taken as a high-risk factor. And when do we say papillary muscles are hypertrophied is if the thickness of the papillary muscle exceeds 11 millimeters. Okay. Anomalous insertion of the papillary muscles occurs in about 10% of the patients with HCM. Okay. So, can you identify at the bedside between MR caused by the SAM versus MR caused by abnormal mitral wall apparatus? Would you like to answer?
Hello.
What kind of jet you get it in SAM?
Some posteriorly directed jet, sir.
It is an eccentric jet, right?
Eccentric, yes, sir.
Yeah. So basically, the type of jet, what you get it. And what is the other abnormalities, anatomical abnormalities in HOCM other than hypertrophy?
Sir, can have
one
primary...
papillary muscles, primary abnormalities of the papillary muscles of the mitral apparatus. But I think one study has been published recently, I read it in Circulation. Even in patients who are not obviously obstructive, they have a very much elongated anterior leaflet of the mitral wall. Almost 50% increase in size. Anterior leaflet is very much elongated in all patients with HOCM. So much so it is said that it may be the only manifestation of inherited familial hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, even without LVOT obstruction, even without LVH.
Yes.
When the way it is written down here is, when the length of AML, that is anterior mitral leaflet, is more than the double the LVOT size, obstruction always occurs. Very rarely, elongation of the PML can also occur in patients with HOCM. But that is less frequent. But almost in 100% of the patients with HOCM, symptomatic, asymptomatic, hypertrophic, non-hypertrophic, the AML size is very much increased in length, elongated, in all patients with HOCM, without exception. And when the length is more than double the LVOT, obstruction is almost as a rule. So you need to, you know, I have made a note, so I'm just reading out my notes in these things. So what are the types of HCM? What do you get it? What are the patterns of LV hypertrophy?
First thing, asymmetrical septal hypertrophy, sir. Apical HCM.
Wait. You should listen to the question. Tell me the order of the type of hypertrophy in HCM.
Sir, could be septal.
The most frequent pattern of LVH in HCM.
Septal. Asymmetrical hypertrophy of septum.
Dr. Lakshman, do you agree on that?
Yes, sir. Asymmetrical septal hypertrophy or apical hypertrophy.
Dr. Logre, do you agree on that?
Sir, I'm sorry, I missed that part, sir. I missed the question.
You need to say you missed the question. What is the frequency of the type of LVH in HCM?
Concentric left ventricular hypertrophy is the most common, sir, approximately 45 to 50%.
Absolutely right. That's the most frequent form. 2% is apical HCM. But in
Japan,
but in Japan it is 25%. The remaining ones are classical asymmetric septal hypertrophy is one form, reversed sigmoid is another one, midventricular obstruction is another one, and the least common is lateral wall hypertrophy. RV involvement in HCM is only 18%. Okay. So in the examination, if you say that what is the most common pattern of hypertrophy of the LV, 42% is concentric LVH without obstruction. Okay?
Yes.
Rajesh and...
Yes, sir. I am listening,
sir. Yes. It is all given in this book. I have made the notes, so I am reading out the notes so that at least people can know what is happening. So, morphological abnormalities in HOCM is hypertrophy with myocyte disarray. Myocyte disarray, more than 10% of the sections. Marked increase in the interstitial fibrosis and replacement fibrosis. And finally, dysplasia of the small vessels, intramural CAD. Okay. That is the one. That is perivascular fibrosis, luminal narrowing due to smooth muscle cell hypertrophy of the intima and media. And density of the small vessels compared to the muscles is markedly decreased. These are all morphological abnormalities within the hypertrophied muscle. Is it clear? So what is the what is the histological hallmark of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy?
Disarray of muscle cells.
Yeah. Disarray of the hypertrophy of the muscle cells. And myocyte disarray more than 10%. Because myocyte disarray has been described even in congenital heart diseases. So they say that disarray has to be more than 10%. Then only we say it is hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. Coupled with that, you should have in marked increase in the interstitial fibrosis and replacement fibrosis. And dysplasia of the small vessels, intramural CAD. This is also important. This forms the basis of your myocardial perfusion imaging abnormality. Is it clear?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So please read it and, you know, because I read it about 6 months back and made some notes. That's why I'm reading my notes.
Okay, sir. Okay.
Okay.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
I think it's about 6:20 now, 6:50. So we will close the for today's discussion.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
I think you need to know about risk stratification. You need to know what are the morphological abnormalities, especially the morphological abnormalities involving the mitral apparatus. Okay?
Yes. Yes, sir. Yes.
Right, then. Right.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Right.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Right.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.